When this ship was launched in 1959, it stunned the world.
This is a very special ship, the first one of her kind, the only one of her kind today.
For one, it was very flashy, with luxurious cabins, a swimming pool, and this lounge, which looks straight out of Mad Men. But hiding underneath this glitzy surface was what really set the NS Savannah apart from pretty much every other ship built before it. Because the N in its name actually stood for
Nuclear Ship Savannah.
Nuclear. It wasn't powered by a diesel engine, but by a nuclear reactor, meticulously maneuvered into its hull. The Savannah was supposed to showcase that nuclear energy could power just about everything, even ships. It carried up to 60 passengers and around 10,000 tons of cargo, and could go for years without refueling. Today's top military still use secret nuclear tech to power their submarines and aircraft carriers. But only three other nuclear cargo ships were built, ever. And some people think now is the time to give the idea a second chance. This map shows why. What looks like lots and lots of tiny paper planes are actually all the cargo ships at sea. These constant streams of floating steel are what keep the global economy moving, carrying more than 80% of internationally traded goods from sellers to buyers. But while doing so, many of them are burning tons and tons of this stuff every day, heavy fuel oil. Their smokestacks are relentlessly spewing toxic pollutants into the air, as well as climate warming CO2. Every year, the shipping industry emits almost as much of it as Japan. The UN body responsible, the International Maritime Organization, wants to clean this up. By or around 2050, the industry is supposed to reach net zero emissions. The only question is, how? Putting batteries on cargo ships going long distances would make them so heavy they couldn't carry much freight. Alternative fuels like ammonia or methanol could do the trick, but making them requires huge amounts of renewable electricity, so there won't be much of them anytime soon. And that's why people are getting excited about nuclear ships again.
For starters, it will have no emissions. So it will basically be a very, very, very clean ship.
This is Jan Emblensvåg, an engineering professor who, according to his wife, spends all his living daylights working on nuclear ships.
It's like almost working on your hobby.
He's the lead author of this study that looks into what it would take to build them.
Well, one of the reactor technologies that we are working on, we have already done some cost calculations, and they indicate that the fuel cost will be roughly 40% cheaper than heavy fuel oil.
That's because nuclear packs a lot of energy into a small space. Depending on the size and type of reactor, nuclear ships can run for years without having to refuel.
And that, of course, gives a tremendous range.
Today's container ships running on fuel oil typically don't manage a whole trip around the world in one go. But back in the day, the Savannah, for example, could go
14 times around the world on a single fuel load.
And this was made possible by the nuclear reactor inside the Savannah's hull. Inside it, the splitting of atoms created heat, which was used to make steam. This steam spun a turbine, which turned the ship's propeller. This was all before the big nuclear accidents on land made people wary of nuclear energy. But still, the engineers had come up with a bunch of ways to keep the people on board and the ship's surroundings safe.
Complex system of shielding is constructed. Retractable stabilizers, which were designed to counter any roll in a heavy sea. This makes her one of the safest ships afloat.
The ship was also run by a specially trained crew that followed strict safety protocols. The problem was that all this, of course, cost quite a lot of money. And the Savannah couldn't just enter any port it wanted, it always needed one-off special permission, which was cumbersome to negotiate. For these reasons, in 1971 it was eventually decommissioned. Of the cargo ships that came after it, only the Russian Sevmoput is still in service, but nearing retirement. The other two were also decommissioned because they ran into similar problems to the NS Savannah. But since then, things have changed.
Today, what is really different is that Generation 4 technologies has opened up a lot of new possibilities that we are currently exploring.
Generation 4 technologies are a whole host of reactor types that are supposed to be a step up from the pressurized water reactor that's the most common today and also powered the Savannah.
I think this can be related to other areas of technology, like computers. At one time, they took up the size of a building, but the technology has advanced and changed. The same is absolutely true of nuclear for maritime.
Mark Tipping is responsible for new shipping technologies at Lloyd's Register. They're a classification society that checks whether ships meet international standards before they can go out to sea.
The technologies that we're looking at today for maritime are very different to what was applied in the 1960s and 70s.
The study I showed you earlier looked at more than 80 new reactor concepts and whittled them down to three that are best suited to work in ships.
We developed 37 criteria to arrive at those three. And of course, I'm not going to bother you with all 37 criteria here. But of course, some of them are very important. For example, safety.
Pressurized water reactors, like the one that used to be on the Savannah, need active intervention when things go wrong. Additional pumps would have to be turned on, for example.
These new technologies take that out of the equation. If something goes wrong, it fails safe. It doesn't need people to achieve that.
You might want to check out this video here later, where we took a deep dive into one of these technologies. Many of these new reactors are also supposed to operate at low pressures, and that could help immensely in dealing with what's called emergency planning zones, kind of a safety bubble around nuclear reactors where special safety measures apply. For pressurized water reactors on land, these can extend several kilometers around the power plant.
They are driven by the fact that when you have a pressure vessel with very high pressure, if it ruptures, it will create a big explosion.
For ships moving across oceans and wanting to go into ports, that's impractical, to say the least. But passively safe reactors operating at low pressures may fix that problem.
Your very worst bad day, something going wrong, you can keep it within the ship, which allows you to reduce that emergency planning zone down to the ship, because there isn't anything that can happen outside of it to start with.
The hope is that this would make going into ports a whole lot easier. Another hope is that these reactors will be cheaper than those of the past.
These reactors are very small. One term that's often used is micro reactors. That means that we can manufacture them like products. When the volume becomes large enough, you can produce them in factories in very large numbers.
So according to the proponents, modern nuclear ships are a no-brainer. They are cleaner and cheaper than cargo ships running on oil, and thanks to new reactor technologies, a lot safer than the nuclear ships of the past. But the thing is, all this still needs to be proven in the real world. No such reactors for ships have been built yet, let alone the supply chains needed to mass produce them. We're still very much at the stage of flashy 3D sketches of what these ships might look like. We wanted to ask the three biggest shipping companies how much potential they see in nuclear, but none of them agreed to an interview. Perhaps because there are still a lot of things to figure out before these ships can ever set sail. This document sets out the international safety rules for civilian nuclear ships. The problem is that it's from 1981 and only covers pressurized water reactors.
Both nuclear technology and ship technology developed significantly over these more than 40 years.
This is Ricardo Batista of the International Maritime Organization, the UN body that's responsible for international shipping regulations. Recently, they agreed the old code needs an update.
We need to understand, for the different new nuclear technologies, which are the hazards, what is the safety case for them, and then from there develop the relevant mitigation measures that can be incorporated in the new code.
This will include tackling some pretty serious questions, like when a ship sinks, how can we prevent radioactive material from leaking? How do we stop it from falling into the hands of terrorists? And how do we handle the nuclear waste? Updating the safety code alone is expected to take years, but that's really just the start.
The big question is, how do we handle the insurance?
International regulatory framework.
We would look for a national regulator.
The class societies, the insurance companies.
Ports have their own regulations. They will also need to be developed at the same time as we are developing the regulations.
I think you get the gist. There's a lot to do. But all the different sites are talking. Jan's research group, for example, is bringing together nuclear scientists, ship engineers, legal experts, and so on. Many believe that hashing out all the bureaucracy will actually take longer than developing and building reactors and ships. So when do the experts think we might see nuclear cargo ships take to the sea again?
We will see the very first of this new generation of ships with these new technologies in the early 2030s.
2031, 2034, maybe 5, something like that, for the first ones.
Which certainly sounds like an ambitious timeline, seeing that neither technology nor regulations are in place. But if the shipping sector really wants to clean up its act, it will need any technology that can help it, fast. As Jan put it in the foreword to his study.
We shall certainly do our best, and then our children can judge our efforts.
Now, how do you feel about putting nuclear reactors on ships? Is this really a good idea? Let us know in the comments. Don't forget to hit subscribe and head to dw.com for more stories like this one.